So, like he said, I'm Aaron. Thank you for the awesome introduction. I've been doing web development for a little over 15 years now. And during that time, I have slowly built up my reputation and been able to leverage that to do the things that I want to do. And I want to kind of take a look at my experience, at the path that I took, and hopefully look at not just some of my successes, but also some of my mistakes, and use those to show you guys how you can also build your reputation and use it to be able to do whatever it is that you want to do, even if what you want to do is pretty drastically different from what I want to do. But in order to understand some of my earlier successes and mistakes, you have to understand a little bit about where I started. And the most important thing that you need to understand is that I became a developer by accident. I did not set out to be a developer. As a matter of fact, my plan was to go into network administration. I had trained to work on some of the big routers and switches that sort of direct traffic all over this internet that we use. Cisco certified, that sort of thing. That was the plan. But while I was looking for a job doing that, something sort of interesting happened. My dad came to me, and at the time he owned an auto transport company, extremely non-technical, that shipped cars all through the southwestern United States. And his company had been growing, and he was having a hard time finding enough people to staff his office to dispatch his trucks. And he came to me and said, while you're looking for a job doing what you want to do, why don't you come to work for me? That way I have a little bit more time to find people, because he was having such a hard time doing that, and you won't go broke while you look for a job, which sounds kind of fantastic. So I took him up on that. I went to work for him for a little while, being very clear that, hey, if I find the right job, I am out of here, because I want to do something much more technical than this. And as I started working in his office full time, it was a family-owned company, so I'd been there lots before to help out, just to do various things. But it wasn't until I started working there full time that I realized there was a huge problem with my dad's organization. And that was, he'd grown really fast. He was shipping thousands of cars on a fleet of maybe 50 or so trucks all through the southwestern United States. And that whole organization had one computer. One computer, and it was only used for billing, nothing else. The way that they tracked all of those vehicles and where all their trucks were and what work was finished and still needed to be done was on giant whiteboards, 4-foot by 8-foot whiteboards that lined every inch of the walls in the office. The whiteboards had been divided into lines and cells and looked like some horrible Excel spreadsheet brought to life and pasted up on the wall full size. It had all the downsides of running your entire company using an Excel spreadsheet. And you couldn't even use like copy and paste or autofill. I mean, there were a lot of problems with the system. But the biggest problem by far was that the system didn't scale at all. His company was growing and he was being held back because he didn't have room for more whiteboards in his office. I mean, literally limited by wall space. And so I told him that I understand that you think technology is scary, but it is time to computerize, and I am going to help you do that while I'm here. Fast forward a few months, and I looked at tons of software packages for trucking, and none of them were going to work. Some of them were horribly bad, and some of them just weren't able to handle the kind of trucking that he did. So I said, well, hey, why don't I write you something? Yeah, I just said it just like that. I had no idea what I was doing, but I did. And little did I know that those casually, almost flippantly spoken words were going to completely change a career that hadn't even started yet. But they did. And the reason that they did is because as I began to do this, as I began to write this software for him, I found that I really enjoyed it. I really liked writing code. And so I decided that because that was more fun, that's what I wanted to do. Forget the fact that I had, you know, trained and planned on this other thing. I'm going to do this new fun thing instead. And it was actually right there at the very beginning of my career, before it was even really a career, just as I was getting started, that I realized I had my first big success, something big that was going to change the way that I, or affect the way that I built my reputation for the rest of my entire career. And that was that I chose to do something that I enjoyed. And it may sound silly or possibly too good to be true, but as I looked back at this process of building my reputation, this was actually extremely important. And the reason is that building your reputation takes work. It takes a time investment. It takes energy and it takes effort. And because I enjoyed doing it so much, I was more than willing to put in that time and that energy and that effort. Looking back, had I not enjoyed it so much, there are times that I would not have, that I don't think I would have pushed through. So doing what I enjoy has actually drastically affected my ability to build my reputation. And I think that it will drastically affect your ability as well. Now, it's way too easy to start off with just a success. That wasn't very realistic. So as I looked back at this same time, right as I'm starting, I also made a really big mistake. I was so excited to do this thing that I found that I loved that I jumped in with both feet and no plan at all. No plan whatsoever. Now, who here has ever played with bottle rockets before? Yeah, I have to confess, pretty much anything that involves fire or explosions, I love. And bottle rockets are this wonderful, tiny little package of both, right? For those that don't know, bottle rockets are a long, skinny stick with a little tiny, about 2 inch by 1/4 inch in diameter piece at the end with a fuse sticking out. You light that fuse, you get that satisfying little and after a couple seconds, shoots right into the air. Satisfying pop, it's amazing. And the reason it's so amazing is because you don't expect that amount of energy out of such a tiny little package, but they give it to you. And the funny thing is, the part that I want to talk about the bottle rocket, is actually that little stick that everybody sort of looks right past. Everybody assumes that that's either to set in a bottle or possibly to hold on to, depending on how adventurous you are, when you set them off. And that may be true, but they actually play a very important role in what a bottle rocket does. The fact that that stick trails behind as the bottle rocket shoots into the air is what keeps the bottle rocket going in the same direction. It's the same way that the tail of a kite keeps the kite pointed into the wind. And at this beginning part of my career, right when I started, I had tons of energy and excitement, like the power packed into that tiny little bottle rocket. But I didn't have a plan. I didn't have that stick to keep me going in the right direction. For those of you that have played with bottle rockets, who has attempted to remove or cut that stick off before lighting it? Yeah, I do not recommend doing this. But what happens is you light the bottle rocket and it has just as much energy, goes with just as much speed, but you have no clue where it's going to go. It may spin around and blow up 2 feet away from you. It may shoot up into the air and come right back at you. Or it may go off, you know, who knows where. And this was me at the very beginning. I had tons of energy and zero direction. direction because I didn't take the time to make a plan. But as I look back on this time, the energy did sort of save me. The fact that I really enjoyed what I was doing helped me push through. As a matter of fact, as I look back at this time, it kind of made me tired. I have no idea how I did as much as I did. But while I was building the software for my dad's company, I started to freelance as well. Not awesome, amazing projects, tiny little things off of sites like Odesk, Renacoder, freelancer.com, those kinds of things. Just because I enjoyed doing it so much, I wanted more. I wanted to learn more. It was exciting to me. But one of the first things that I noticed was that getting work was really hard. Even these tiny little jobs that paid almost nothing were really hard for me to get. And that's because nothing differentiated me from the thousands of other developers that wanted those same projects. But I kept pushing through, and at one point I finally got a project to build an entire website. Up until then it had been fix this little thing that was broken, add this little bit of new functionality, but for the first time I built the entire site, and when I finished I was super excited. I added that site to my portfolio, right? And 2 days later, I got contacted and somebody said, hey, I saw that you built this other site. I want one very similar to that. I'd like to hire you to do that. And I was blown away. I mean, after working so hard to get every little project, all of a sudden, a good project just came to me. I wanted more of that. And this, as I look back, was really my first glimpse at what reputation can really do for you. And I really wanted this first glimpse of the power of reputation to be another wonderful success along the way. But as I was putting this talk together and looking back at it, I realized that it wasn't. I kind of screwed it up. I messed it up, and it turned into another mistake. And that's because I thought that it was my portfolio that brought me this additional work. And your portfolio is not the same as your reputation. Your portfolio might be a small part of your reputation, but it is not your reputation. Let me say that one more time. Your portfolio is not the same as your reputation. Your reputation is much more than just your portfolio. And the danger of confusing them is exactly what happened to me. I ended up with blinders on, with tunnel vision, and I was focused solely on building my portfolio. And because that's only one small part of your overall reputation, that meant that even though I was putting tons of time and energy and effort into building my portfolio, my reputation was actually growing very slowly. It felt like a big struggle trying to grow my reputation. And getting work was still difficult, but because it is part of your reputation, I was making progress. It was just, as I look back, I missed out on so many other extremely valuable ways that I could have been growing my reputation, and I ended up doing it the slow way instead. But it was during this time, as I slowly built my reputation, that I started my first company and started getting more and more projects, and I had something happen to me that turned out to be a little bit lucky, but I made a decision that ended up drastically changing the way that I've built my reputation ever since. And this is that. And I know it's code in a more businessy type talk. You don't have to know what the code does. All you have to know is that this is my first ever contribution to WordPress Core. I had a client that I built a site for, came across a bug in WordPress, fixed it for them, but decided that I also wanted to try to get that fix put into WordPress Core so that the next time we upgraded it wouldn't break. And I did that mostly just because it intrigued me. I didn't know at the time that this was going to forever change the way that I built my reputation, but it did. And I learned all about our WordPress's bug tracker and how to generate a diff with version control, and went through this whole process. And on June 12, 2007, this went into WordPress core. And it felt really good. I was excited that when the next version, 2.3, came out, thousands of people were going to be using my code. That was exciting to me. So for no other reason than that it was exciting, I continued to contribute to WordPress core. I continued to give more and more more and more of my time to giving back and trying to push WordPress ahead. And in only a few months, I started to notice that some of the work that was coming in was not because of all the time and energy and effort that I had put into painstakingly building up my portfolio. Some of it was coming in because people saw that I was working on WordPress core. And they said, well, if you can help build WordPress, you can probably build something on WordPress. And I had this light bulb moment where I realized that you can build your reputation outside of just your work. Your reputation doesn't have to be built just with your portfolio, just with your paying clients, just with your day job. You can build your reputation in lots of ways. And as I started to realize that, I looked around for other ways and began to write and release plugins in the WordPress repository. As a developer, these are the things that I found, that I did. And yours may be different, but I continued to contribute to WordPress core. I started releasing plugins. I went to events like this, shared my knowledge, spoke. And the ways that you find to build your reputation will likely be different. But they will be way more than just your paying clients, than just your paying job. And so I want to encourage you to look around. Look for those other opportunities, other ways that you can build your reputation, and go for them. Because at this time, as I started having multiple venues for building my reputation, it started to progress very quickly. Instead of growing slowly and taking so much time and effort, it began to grow much, much faster. And so much work started coming in that I got to begin to be a little bit selective. I could turn down some of the jobs because it was actually more work than I could do. And that's when I realized my first mistake, that no plan thing, and I turned it into a success. I finally sat down and I made a plan. And this is actually ridiculously simple to do. All you have to do is ask yourself, what do I want? What do I want? And then take the time to answer that honestly and completely and write it down and keep it someplace that you can reference back. That's going to be important. And I did this. I sat down and I tried to figure out what is it that I want. And at the time, I wanted to continue to own my own company. The freedoms that brought me were something I really enjoyed, so I wanted that. I wanted to make lots of money. I'm sure that there's plenty of you here that have that same desire. I wanted to be location agnostic. I didn't want to be tied to any specific location. I wanted to be able to move wherever, work from wherever. That was very important to me. And I wanted to work for bigger clients. I found that bigger clients tended to ask me to cut corners less often. I hated cutting corners. So this was kind of what my list looked like at the time. And I took that list and I used it to compare against with everything that I did. If it was a client that I was deciding whether to take the work or pass on it, I would look and say, is this going to send me in the direction that I'm wanting to go? I now had that stick on my bottle rocket. I could aim it in a specific direction and light it, and now when I was putting in all that energy, I was making progress towards where I realized I wanted to be. And it worked. All of a sudden, having this direction, I started to be able to work with the kinds of clients that I wanted to. For example, I was working with Harvard Law and Time Magazine around this time, and it was great. I thought that I was really getting the hang of managing my reputation. But as it turns out, I wasn't quite there. I was still missing a big piece. I just didn't realize I was missing it until I started my second company. A few years ago, I joined forces with two other people from the WordPress community, and we started a company called Ranch. And we worked almost solely with these bigger clients, which meant that we wrote a lot of very lengthy proposals. And one of my partners in that venture wanted to add a whole section to our proposal that did nothing except showcase our reputation. Not just our portfolio, not just a list of clients that we had worked with, even though that was a pretty impressive list, but actually talk about places that we've been invited to speak at, other plugins that we maintain for free, these kinds of things. And I was actually against this. I thought that it felt like bragging, so I thought that it was a bad idea. I was wrong. When you've put in the time and effort to build your reputation, it's okay to take advantage of it. It's okay to use it. And when I acquiesced and we added this to our proposals, this whole section, there was a measurable uptick in the number of those proposals that we sent out that came back as paying clients. And as if that weren't enough to convince me that this was a good idea, there was also a measurable reduction in the amount of time and effort that we had to place into everything between sending out the proposal and having the paying client. The phone calls that you usually had to convince them that you were the right company for the job, they got shorter, they got easier, because they were already partially convinced by our reputation that we had put out there on display for them. And that was when I realized that all this time and effort that you put into building your reputation, if you actually put it to work and leverage that, it can do a lot of the heavy lifting for you. And that's your return on investment, because like I said, it takes time and energy and effort, and once you start to leverage it, that's when it starts to come back to you. But as much as I was now feeling like I really had the hang of reputation and feeling like I was really starting to move along and put it to good use, my life changed kind of drastically at that time. And this is why. These are my grandparents. This is George and Mary Nelson. And my grandpa has Alzheimer's. And it was around this time that his Alzheimer's took a pretty bad downturn. My grandma has a lot of health problems, one of them being her heart. She was about 84 at this time and ended up having to go in for open heart surgery. And my grandparents played a really big role in my life growing up, and also in my wife's life, who was friends of ours when we were young. And it was really important to us to be able to go out and help take care of my grandparents, who at the time lived in this tiny little place in Oklahoma called Wewoka, Oklahoma. You can't find it on a map unless you use Google, I guarantee. But luckily for me, one of my goals, one of the things that I had wanted and therefore worked towards, was to be location agnostic. And I was lucky enough to be in a position to be able to move out and help take care of them. And we packed everything up, we moved out there, and I thought that I was right where I wanted to be, except that time and effort that was required for running a growing company was really getting in the way of doing things that I now considered more important than that. And so I realized that I no longer wanted to do the same things that I had wanted to do before. Luckily, I had kind of learned from my past. So I sat down and asked myself this question again. What do I want? This is the thing that everybody here should do today. This is your making a plan. Ask yourself what you want. If you've never done this before, it's important to do today. If you've done it, but it's been a little while, it's important to do today. Because these things change, and you want to make sure that if you're building your reputation, you're building it towards what you want. And so I did. I sat down and I made a list, very similar to the first time that I did it. And when I did, I realized, A, that I should do this more often. And B, that my lists were nothing alike. Whereas before I wanted to own my own company, now I realized that was kind of getting in the way of things that I wanted. The money wasn't quite as important. I had these other things that were more important to me. The being location agnostic, while that was still a cool idea and something I liked, for now, my location is, we won't go to Oklahoma, and I don't want to go anywhere else. And as I looked at these lists and realized how drastically different they were, I realized I needed to be doing something completely different. And that was a little bit terrifying, because I had spent a lot of years pointed in one direction and putting all my time and energy into doing that, and I wasn't sure how easy it would be to pivot and change. But luckily, reputation, the reputation that I had built, even though it wasn't exactly for what I now wanted to do, it still allowed me to change and pivot and do exactly what I want. I took that second list, that more recent list that I had made of all the things that I wanted, and I actually put that into email form and went and talked to my partners at Range and explained why I needed to step back and why it was important. Luckily, they're awesome people, they understood. I stepped back from Range and I sent that email off to a handful of companies that I thought would be able to offer me something that would let me accomplish the new list of things that I wanted. And that was how I ended up at iThemes. But the thing is, iThemes didn't hire me because of my amazing portfolio. I didn't send them my portfolio. I suppose they may have poked around and seen who I had worked for, but I didn't send that to them. They didn't hire me because of my amazing resume, because I didn't make one. They hired me because of this reputation that I had built up over time. And it really helped me do what I'm doing now, which is spend time with my grandparents while I have it to spend. Which brings us to the most important part of this talk, which is you guys. And how can you build your reputation so that you can do whatever it is that you want to do, whether that's building up a big company and working with gigantic clients, or whether that's spending time with family or camping on the beach and surfing all day. What is it that you want to do? How can you build your reputation to allow you to do that? I think the same things that I discovered apply to everybody, even if the technical way that you go about it is a little bit different. And so looking back, the most important first starting place is to do what you enjoy. You don't want to build your reputation around something that you don't enjoy. As you build your reputation, it's going to take time and effort. And if you don't enjoy what you're doing, it's going to feel like fighting an uphill battle for your whole career. That's not what you want. You're going to sit down today, actually. You're all going to sit down today, and you're going to make a plan. A simple one, by asking yourself, what do I want? You're going to make your list, you're going to write it down, you're going to keep it around so that you can compare it against all your possible work, all your possible speaking engagements, whatever it is that you do, you're going to be able to compare it against your list and say, is this helping me accomplish these things? You're not going to get the same blinders and tunnel vision I had because you're going to know that your portfolio and your reputation are not the same thing. You are going to instead look all over the place, keeping your eyes open constantly. Where can I build my reputation other than just my clients, other than just my day job? And lastly, probably most importantly, as you do these things, you're also going to use your reputation and let it do some of the work for you. You're going to enjoy the benefits of all that time and effort that you have sunk into building your reputation. And that is all I have for you today, but I think we have plenty of time for questions, yes? We have a mic to run around for questions so that we can make sure that it gets on the recording. So if anybody has questions, raise your hand so you can bring you a mic. I know the first question is always the hardest one to ask.
Any thoughts on where asking for referrals comes into play, maybe?
Yeah, so that's an interesting thing for me that that came in several different forms at various times during my career, I guess. At the beginning, most of my referrals came from other clients that I had worked for that were referring clients back to me. But that time that I talked about where my reputation started to grow faster, where I started getting more involved in other ways of building my reputation. I had referrals coming in lots of ways, from everything from other people that work on core to other people that were at events like this. And the biggest thing that I noticed, being on both sides of the referring process, is that you want to refer work to somebody that you trust and that you know is capable of doing the work that you're referring. And people don't know what you're capable of unless you're out there interacting with them and letting them see that. And so for me, as I contributed to Core, as I started releasing plugins, more people were able to see what I was capable of, and therefore more people were comfortable referring work to me. And that's going to be different for everybody, depending on what sort of industry you work with and what things that you do. But I think that the biggest thing is to make sure that you are putting yourself out there where everybody can see what it is that you're capable of and what they can comfortably refer to you. And I think that it is okay to ask people to refer work to you as long as you understand that they're only going to refer as much to you as they feel like you can actually do, that they know that you can do. Does that answer what you were asking?
Absolutely.
Good.
I'm not sure if this is entirely on topic, but speaking as someone who's got a bit of technical background, but who is basically a total newbie in WordPress, what advice would you have for getting up and running quickly and getting on with this?
So, depending on what kind of technical background you have, where did you...
Okay. I've taken a bunch of intro courses in different programming languages, and I worked for 10 years as a very hands-on manager and maintainer of automated document production systems. Taught myself HTML and CSS, did a lot of work on JavaScript, had courses in Java, C, Perl, XML, done quite a bit of noodling around with XML, not a hell of a lot of website development, but I've converted this Windows machine into a dual boot Windows Linux machine. I've installed the LAMP stack, Ruby on Rails. We've got pieces of it all over the place, but never put much of them together.
Yeah, I mean, you're in a place that I think is similar to a lot of people that are, they have a background, but it's not exactly what you're trying to do. But that doesn't mean that background doesn't apply, that all that work that you put into that doesn't carry over. It's just that you have some new stuff to learn, much as I did when I changed to do something completely different. I'm working on products now, when I used to do completely services, and it's really different, but a lot of that still carries over. And putting that out to your potential clients, to the people that you're trying to get work from, is still an important part. Your reputation is there. You have all that experience. You've put in that time and effort. And that's certainly something that you can leverage to move into the WordPress space. And one of the amazing things, having worked in several different spaces, even though the vast majority of the work that I've done has been around WordPress for the last, I guess, 8 or so years, that the WordPress space is an extremely friendly space to work in, whereas lots of the technical areas that I've worked in outside of WordPress are not. And it makes it very easy, because even though you have all these other people around you that are like the competition, they're also all friendly people that are happy to help and refer work and even tell you how they are able to do and accomplish things, rather than treat it all like business secrets. So you're actually moving into a place where you can take that reputation, combine that with some of the friendliness of this community, and you're in a really good place to be able to move ahead easily, I think.
Just really feel I need to add something to that, because that's an excellent point. I am struggling to run the Hartford WordPress meetup. And I'm sure I'm not alone in this, in the realm of the meetups, looking for anybody who really wants to get their feet wet and talking and just taking that first step and building your reputation in your local area, or even maybe not so local, because we're constantly looking for somebody to just come and talk on something that they're confident or strong in, and it doesn't even have to be a major, encompassing all the WordPress type of skill. But whatever niche you're really confident about, come talk about it. It's free, it's friendly, and it's very non-judgmental.
There are a lot of WordPress meetups all over the place, and it's a fantastic place to start, because instead of being a bigger event like this, where you're more nervous to get up and talk to a bunch of people, it's a much smaller group, but it still lets you make those connections and also build your authority as you do. It's fantastic. Anybody else? No other questions?
I'm a deputy with WordCamp Central, and I help make sure that the WordCamps run efficiently, all the organizers need, have everything they need. But a big part of that before the WordCamps is the meetups. And I know, I have meetups in Ohio that I help run, and we struggle to get more than a few people in there. And how I started speaking at WordCamps was I started speaking at a meetup because nobody else wanted to speak. And I was challenged, well, Rich, why don't you speak? And at lunch today, I was talking to people, and I brought up the point, people will come to a WordCamp and say, I didn't see this topic or that topic. I wish somebody would have spoken about it. And what I say to that is, if you have an interest in a topic, then you should speak about it. Yes, it's scary. It's scary up there. No matter how many times you've spoken. No.
Fun.
It's fun and exhilarating, but you know what? I also teach web development, and I have to say that if you touch one person in the audience with learning, it doesn't mean you have to teach them, but if you get them to think about it, then, and it goes towards reputation and things like that, then, you know, contribute back to the community. Start a meetup. I think we have good meetups here, but if you're in an area that doesn't have a meetup, start one. Speak. Ask questions. All of that. It's all important. And it's very non-judgmental. That's one thing I love about the WordPress community. It is so non-judgmental. We are all here to learn and help each other.
That's true.
Any other questions? Oh, we have one. And get your exercise.
Okay. So my question is, how much do you think that having live contact with your clients or potential clients is? Because I'm a freelancer and all my clients are in Europe, so I can go to meetings, I can go to, you know, do a presentation for people there. So I have to do everything online, and I'm wondering, I find it really difficult to build my reputation then, so what are your thoughts on that?
So, I am a remote worker still, even though the company that I work for is in the same state as me, and the office is only about an hour and a half away. I work from home, and my entire 15 years, I have always worked that way. Some of the clients that I had were nearby. Many of them I never ever met. I never ever saw face to face. And we're in an interesting industry where that's possible. Is seeing your client face to face beneficial? Sometimes. Is it necessary to be able to do what you do? Probably not. But is it helpful for building your reputation? I think so. I think that seeing people face to face is helpful for building your reputation. But you don't just have to build your reputation around the clients or the people that you're working with. You can build that locally, wherever you're at, talking at meetups near you. Just because none of your clients see that doesn't mean that that's not still beneficial to you, that you're not still raising your profile by being able to say that I speak at these, or making connections. Maybe you'll end up with clients near you because you went to those. So I don't think that you have to worry necessarily about being in the same area as your clients to build your reputation. You can have clients far away and still build your reputation by going someplace local. Anyone else?
We have about 1 minute. Time for one more.
It is not necessarily a question, but a suggestion. I am a business owner. I have nothing to do with the WordPress community, but I came here to learn because I realized I need to ask questions to the people I hire. The problem is I don't know what the questions are. And I've learned a lot of the things I need to ask now. Now the question for me is, how I don't have the time to go through all of this, architecture, all of those. So do stop to educate business people. You'll get a lot more business.
That is true. And a lot of times when companies come to you and they want to hire you to work for them, a lot of us freelancers especially tend to put a lot of the work, a lot of the questions back on the business owner. But they have hired you because you're the expert. Own that role. Take that on. Answer those questions for them. Because if they knew how to do it themselves, they would, right? They're hiring you because you're the professional. That's a very good point. Own that. Do that. And I think that's it.
We're out of time. Thank you.